Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh and we are going to start with our daily current affairs for today. Today you have 30th January 2021 and we are basically covering your day-to-day current affairs through these lectures. So you can refer these lectures, right? As well as you should also read the national newspapers, right? Like The Hindu. And the second is Indian Express. Okay, both of these newspapers are equally good. You can refer any of these newspapers. Okay, but the time limit for covering this newspaper should be around 45 minutes to 60 minutes only. So you should never exceed the time of around 45 minutes of reading any of these newspapers. All right, so both of these newspapers are equally good. You should read both of these newspapers, right? And these current affairs classes would be useful for your civil services examination, which is conducted by the UPSC, as well as other government competitive examinations, which require the few questions, or which basically ask few questions from current affairs. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. All right, so the economic survey for 2020-2021 has come. All right. And I'm basically going to give you the basic glimpse or basic, you know, the features of economic survey related to the different sectors. For example, agriculture, health, education. Okay. So I'm going to give you one by one the basic glimpse of the economic survey 2020 and 2021. All right. So let's begin with first agriculture. So all of you knows about the agriculture. Okay. So agriculture and allied activities, or agriculture and the allied sector, is one such, you know, a sector where agriculture as well as allied activities are involved. All right. So here the economic survey says that the agriculture and the allied sector basically has the growth rate of 3.4% at a constant price during 2020 and 2021. All right. It is based on the first advance estimate. Okay. For the economic survey 2020 and 2021. So this year, or according to this economic survey 2020-21, okay, according to first advance estimate, the agriculture and the allied sector basically grows at 3.4% at the constant prices. All right. So when you compare basically with, you know, the provisional estimate released by the CSO on 29th of May 2020, okay, based on the income level or based on the national income, the share of agriculture in the allied sector basically in gross value addition of the country stood at 17.8% for the year of 2019-20. All right. So based on the CSO estimate, right, or based on the provisional estimate of national income, which is released by CSO, okay, in 2020, the share of agriculture in the allied sector basically grows or basically stand at, you know, 17.8% of, you know, in gross value addition. When you compare, you know, agriculture year in 2019-20, in the next point, right, total food grain production, right, total food grain production means you have like wheat, right, rice, etc. So these food grain production stood, right, at 296.65 million tons. Okay, so it is itself is a higher side when you compare like in the last year. So this year in 2019-20, according to 2020-21 census or the economic survey, all right, in 2019-20, we have the data for 2019-20, we had the 296.65 million tons of the food grains, which produced in India. Okay. We had the data also for 2018-19. In year of 2018-19, we had, you know, the comparatively lesser amount of food grain production. So in 2019-20, around 11.44 million tons of additional food grains was produced in our country. All right. So that means when you compare 2018-19, the 2019-20 has the more, you know, the food grain production by around 11.44 million tons. All right. Okay. And if you want to compare with, you know, the export destinations where our agricultural and, you know, the allied sector basically, you know, export. So the major destinations basically, or those major countries basically, USA, United States of America, Saudi Arabia, Iran, Nepal, and Bangladesh. So in 2019-20, these were the major destinations of our agricultural exports. All right. And the items which were exported from India were basically, you know, basically marine products. All right. The basmati rice, buffalo meat, spices, non-basmati rice, cotton raw, oil meals, sugar, and castor oil and tea. So these were the major agricultural items. I'm just putting here agricultural items because you must understand, because I'm here referring to, you know, the economic survey 2020-21 with respect to the basic glimpse of agriculture, right? All right. And when you compare with the livestock, okay, livestock means, you know, you have the animals also like cow, buffaloes also, you know, gives a lot of, you know, value addition to the agriculture. So if you compare, you know, within agriculture and allied sectors, the livestock also, right, in the total agricultural and allied sector, gross value addition, okay, at the constant price has increased, you know, from 24.32% to 28.63% in 2018-19. That means out of 100% in the agricultural and allied sectors gross value addition, 28.63% of this gross value addition comes from the livestock only. So that means almost you say 1/3 of the gross value addition in the agriculture and the allied sector basically comes from the livestock sector. All right, this is very clear. And here, when you compare out of total 100% gross value addition, when you compare or when you take all sectors together, right, the livestock sector contributed just 4.19% of total gross value addition 2018-19. Okay, so two data are very clear. So the first two lines basically signify within agriculture and the allied sector, the gross value addition, the livestock sector stands for 28.63% in 2018-19. Okay, the third line basically indicate the overall gross value addition in our economy. Okay, out of 100%, 4.19% basically stand for the contribution from livestock sector. All right. And when you compare the food processing industries, because food processing industries are basically having, you know, the growth rate, very good growth rate. So in the last 5 years, right, if you compare these food processing industries, the average annual growth rate, right, of these food processing industries stood around 9.99%, which is much, much higher. Okay. If you compare these food processing industries, right, with agriculture, so agriculture just stands for 3.12% as, you know, the constant prices, right? And if you compare even manufacturing also, which is stood at 8.25%, okay? So that means the food processing industries has the higher, the average annual growth rate when you compare in the last 5 years, which is ending in 2018-19, all right? At 2011-12 prices, which we are considering as a constant prices, all right? And let's see here the agriculture and the allied sectors. So this poster, you can see here the growth rate of the gross value addition at the basic prices in 2011-12 level. Okay, at that level 2017-18, the growth rate, right, of from the agriculture and allied sector was standing 5.9%. In 2018-19, it slumps to 2.4%. Again in 2019-20, it's again hiked to 4%. And again, it slumped to 3.4%. Okay, so it is not continuously increasing or decreasing, but it is something fluctuating, okay, as per the economic survey reports. Okay, let's understand the bare necessities. Okay, so the bare necessities basically are those items, okay, where, you know, the human sustenance is, you know, dependent on them, right, without which we cannot survive, or the bare necessities are needed for the, you know, for life to sustain, right? Here the bare necessities may be, you know, the water, sanitation, housing, right? These are the some of the bare necessities which require. Okay, so in order to, you know, quantify or in order to include the bare necessities, right, the economic survey 2020-21 basically constructs the bare necessity index. Okay, so this bare necessity index calculated at a rural level, urban level, and all India level. Okay, now this bare necessity index was also created before also in 2012 and 2018. Okay, these two, you know, years the bare necessity index was calculated or constructed. Okay, now this bare necessity index was again constructed in 2020-21 year. All right, so we will have the data of bare necessity index of year 2018 and 2012. Okay, because this year they have constructed, so this data may come in the next year or next next year. All right, so let's understand first bare necessity index. So bare necessity index basically comprises around 26 indicators, okay, on the five dimensions. These five broader dimensions are basically the water, which is the most you know, the pressing necessity for human survival, then sanitation, okay. Third is basically housing, right. Fourth is micro environment, and the fifth is other such facilities which require the human to survive. Okay, so as I told you that these are the five dimensions based on which, you know, the bare necessity index will be calculated at rural level, urban level, as well as all India level. All right, and we have already constructed this bare necessity index in 2012 and 2018. So we have the data of 2012 and 2013. Okay, and we have constructed, you know, or created this BNI basically, you know, using the data from, you know, two NSO rounds. So these two NSO rounds, 69th rounds and 76th round on the drinking water, sanitation, hygiene, housing conditions in India. Okay, so we have taken this data from the, you know, from NSO rounds of 69th and 76th rounds of data based on the drinking water, sanitation, hygiene, and housing conditions in India. All right. Okay. If you compare the data in, you know, bare necessity index in 2018 and 12. So here, according to economic survey, okay, in most of the states, right, the access to bare necessities for household in 2018 has significantly better compared to 2012. So that means the bare necessities has increased, or the availability of bare necessities has increased for almost all households in almost all states, okay, which is basically significantly improved when you compare with 2012. Okay, access to drinking water, right, to households, right, in almost all states or in the most of the states has improved when you compare in 2018, right, with 2012. Right, both in rural as well as in the urban areas. So the access to the drinking water also increased. All right, and then basically the regional disparities declined. Okay, these regional disparities declined in almost all states. Okay, because, you know, as you know, having the low access to the sanitation 2012 have also gained more. So these regional disparities in terms of sanitation has declined in almost all states. Okay, when you compare in terms of the housing index, okay, because of, you know, lot of schemes which was implemented by the government of India, okay, due to that effort, the housing availability or improvement of the access to the housing, right, it has, you know, increased, right. Interstate disparities with respect to the housing has reduced. Okay, so you know, the, you know, the lowest income group now is having the, you know, those houses also, dwelling units, so which has significantly improved. All right, and in terms of, you know, the micro environment, the economic survey also noted that in almost all states, okay, except Assam, in rural areas the micro environment has improved, right, and except Orissa and Assam, in urban areas again macro environment is improved when you compare in 2012. Okay, then survey also points out the positive correlation between access to the bare necessities and better health and education outcome. Okay, so survey also outlined that there is a relationship between the bare necessities. If the citizens are having the bare necessities, right, that will have the impact on, or positive impact on, the health and the educations. Okay, so here, you know, there will be improvement in terms of the child survival, in terms of, you know, the malnutrition, in terms of infant mortality rate will decline, right. So that will have the positive correlation between the bare necessities on the health and the educations of those people. All right, so here you can see the bare necessity index, which was, you know, constructed in 2012, right, for rural and urban. It is again 2018 for both rural and urban. So it is basically, you know, the necessity index basically based on certain score. So it is less than 0.50. So you can see it is a red, right? So here the bare necessity index is somewhat lesser. Then yellow one basically shows the bare necessity index is somewhat, you know, good. Okay. But above 0.70 is only the greener one. Okay. Here you see, you know, the below 0.50 has declined further. Okay. 0.5 to 0.7, it has again, you know, increased. and ever 0.70 also increase in certain pockets. Okay, so it is based on certain, you know, the NSO data or National Sample Survey Organization data. Okay, based on which we have basically, you know, calculated this BNI index. Okay, next, the economic survey also gives, you know, certain aspects related to the skill development. Okay, according to economic survey 2020 and 2021, okay, the economic survey says that only 2.4% of the workforce, okay, of the age of 15 to 59 years have received certain set of formal education or formal technical training or vocational education. So you can say out of 100% of your workforce, which is involved in certain set of work in the age bracket of 15 to 59, out of 100%, only 2.4% have certain amount of the formal vocational or the technical training with them. Okay. Another 8.9% of the workforce in the same age bracket of 15 to 59 years, okay, receive that training through informal sources. Right. So here, you know, you can see only 2.4% of the workforce basically received the formal vocational training, right? Remaining has not received any formal training. And 8.9% has also received, but that is through informal sources. Okay. Now let's have the data regarding this 8.9%. So out of this 8.9% of the workforce, which received the training from non-formal, you know, sources. So they are basically, you know, 3.3% basically received, you know, on-job training, right? Just like they just come and started doing work and they just, you know, started learning on this, right? So that is called on-job training. Then self-learning, 2.5% people self-learned. Then hereditary sources, all right? So from hereditary sources, around 2.1%, and other sources also contributed to around 1%, right? So here, 8.9% received the vocational training, right? Only through the informal sources, which is also cause of the concern, because this type of training may not be suitable, right? For better, you know, access to better jobs. But we need, you know, the quality training, right? For that, we need to emphasize on the training and vocational training related framework. All right. And, you know, the most of the people who received this formal training basically opted the training courses like IT related, ITES related, for both males and the females. Okay. Now, recently, the National Council for Vocational Education Training, NCVET, was operationalized. It is nothing but the unified skill regulator, which will regulate the formal, you know, the training for the people. All right. And recently, the Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Vikas Yojana 3rd was also rolled out in 2020-21. The main objective of this Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Vikas Yojana 3 is to skill 8 lakh candidate, right, for certain set of the formal training, including the migrants. So here 8 lakh extra, right, the, you know, the people will be, you know, trained, or vocational training will be provided to them, right? It also include the migrants also. Then related to education, the economic survey also provided certain aspect related to education also. So in the education, it says that the government spending, right? So as you know that the country is basically, evolving or emerging from the COVID related pandemic. Okay. But still we are in the clutches of the COVID, but still vaccination process has started, right? But during this COVID related pandemic, the online education or online schooling basically took off. Okay. So the economic survey basically observed that in 2020-21, the online schooling related, you know, work has took off in a big way, even despite of having this COVID-19 pandemic. Okay. So here, according to this economic survey 2020-21, the percentage of enrolled children, right, from government and the private schools, both, okay, due to this, you know, smartphone availability, right, the percentage of the enrolled children has increased, right, from 36.5% in 2018 to 61.8% in 2020. We are talking only in terms of rural. So in the rural area, both from government and the private schools, the number of children, right, which are getting education through the smartphone, right, or they are enrolled, you know, in certain set of educational institutions, both in the government and the private, has increased from 36.5% in 2018 to 68.5% in 2020, right, in the rural India. Okay, and an initiative called PM E-Vidya, which was, you know, initiated by the government of India, right, ultimately to enable the equitable access to the education for the students as well as for the teachers, right? It will unify, you know, all efforts related to the digital or online education, right? And that will have the positive impact, right, on the access of the education, right, for the students also. Okay. And, you know, around 92 courses have also started, right? And around 1.5 crore students are enrolled under SWAYAM MOOC courses, right? So these are the open courses through which, you know, the 1.5 crore students have been already enrolled. And these online courses are related to NIOS, all right? And you have also guidelines, which are called the Pragyata guidelines. These Pragyata guidelines are related to the digital education, right? The main emphasis of these guidelines is basically focusing on the online or digital education for the students, or quality online education or digital education to the students, right? Only to those students which are basically residing in their house due to, you know, COVID related, you know, pandemic, and due to the closure of those schools because of this COVID related pandemic, right? And the government of India also started, you know, certain set of giving the psychological support also. This psychological support is provided through the Mano Darpan initiative, okay, which involved or which included in the Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan. Okay, so psychological support also provided to the students. Okay, and the India has attained around, you know, 96% of the literacy level, right, at the level of elementary school level. Okay, and as well as the National Sample Survey or NSS data, the literacy rate, right? Literacy, we calculate basically the person who is above the age of 7 years old, who can read and write any language with understanding. Okay, that is the definition of your literacy rate, literacy. Okay, so here, according to NSS sample, right, or NSS survey, the literacy rate of, you know, the people or the person who are basically 7 years and above, okay, at all India level, basically stood at 77.7%. Okay, so which is also a good indicator, but still lesser. Okay, let's understand about the health. Okay, so health, here you must understand, because the government expenditure related to health is very, very low. Okay, so out of pocket expenditure is very, very high because of less government expenditure or less public expenditure on the health sector. Okay, so Economic Survey 2020-21 basically strongly recommended the increase in the public spending on the health services. Okay, so it strongly recommended that the public spending on the health infrastructure or health services should be increased from 1% to around 3% of the GDP. Okay, so that is also emphasized in the National Health Policy 2017. So the Economic Survey 2020-21 strongly recommended that the health expenditure or public health expenditure on the healthcare services should be increased from 1% to around 3%, right, of the GDP. All right. And that will definitely reduce the out-of-pocket expenditure from 69% currently to 35% of the overall health-related spending that people generally spend. Okay, and that will basically, you know, help in reduction of the poverty also, because when the people spend 65% of that expenditure out of their pocket, what will happen, right? They basically pushed, you know, behind the poverty, right? So that will reduce to 65% from 65% to 35%, and that will have the positive impact on the poverty alleviation also. All right, and the sample or the survey basically, or economic survey basically, strongly recommended that the National Health Mission should be continued, right? It should not be stopped, right, in the conjunction with the Ayushman Bharat Yojana. Okay, and as we are all recovering from COVID related or COVID-19 related pandemic, okay, you know, the Economic Survey basically strongly recommended, right, adoption of telemedicine, okay, for meeting of last mile challenge of healthcare delivery in our country, because telemedicine would provide, you know, a certain consultation, right, of, you know, certain set of, you know, the experts from, you know, if they are sitting even in the urban areas, through the telemedicine, we can consult, or we can take the consultation from those doctors, right, who are sitting in the urban areas, and there is a requirement of, you know, urgently, right, certain set of consultation with them. So the telemedicine would provide such platform to, you know, the needy people, right? So healthcare under spotlight, you can see under economic survey. So here health light is the health the health infrastructure should be agile, okay? And you know, for that the national health mission should be continued, okay? And public health spending on the health related expenditure should be increased from 1% to 2.5 to 3% of the GDP, so that it can reduce the out of pocket expenditure from 65% to 35% of the overall health expenditure, and that will basically, you know, help in terms of alleviation of the poverty also. Okay, next, Joy Bangla. Okay, so first of all, what is the Joy Bangla? So the Joy Bangla is basically a slogan. Okay, it's a salutation that we call it sometimes Jai Hind. So something like that. It is a Joy Bangla, right? It is a salutation, especially in the Bangla or the, you know, the Bengali speaking region. So the people used to, you know, use this slogan or their salutation during the Bangladesh liberation, right? Or it is a salutation which basically used by the people, in, especially in the Bengali dominated parts of India. These Bengali dominated parts of India, basically, say in the West Bengal, Tripura, Barak Valley, and Manbhum district, right, where this salutation was used. Okay, so it was used basically to liberate, right, country of Bangladesh from the Pakistan. So it was extensively used to unify that spirit, so that we can liberate the Bangladesh on that time. So now why this Joy Bangla again in the news? So here, you know, the legislative assembly elections are due, right, in the West Bengal. So ruling party, which is All India Trinamool Congress, basically engaged in the Bengal sub-nationalism, right, with the use of this slogan Joy Bangla, right? So the Bangla, so this Joy Bangla, which is a salutation or which is a slogan, right, started, you know, using again, right, in the West Bengal, because the elections are due, and banned All India Trinamool Congress basically engaged in using this slogan Joy Bangla for unifying, right, or for, you know, creating the sense of Bengal sub-nationalism, right, within the West Bengal, so that it can, you know, help the All India Trinamool Congress to achieve, you know, victory in the legislative assembly elections. Okay, you know, this is basically an example of sub-nationalism. So it is indicate basically the nationalism towards a certain set of geopolitical, cultural, and historical region of the Bengal and Bangmata or Mother Bengali. So it is having certain set of, you know, the cultural significance, okay, historical significance, right, geopolitical significance with the Mother Bengali, right? And it basically translates to victory to the Bengal, right, or the Hail Bengal. Okay, this slogan was given by Qazi Nazrul Islam. Okay, the Qazi Nazrul Islam basically, you know, framed a poem named Purna Abhinandan in 1922, and through that, this, you know, Joy Bangla was basically taken, right? And it is basically this Joy Bangla, which is a salutation or which is basically, you know, a slogan which was used by the Mukti Vahini. Mukti Vahini was basically, you know, organization which was basically set up, right, to liberate the Bangladesh from the Pakistan. All right. So this Mukti Vahini was involved of using this Joy Bangla during the Bangladesh liberation in 1971. All right. So here what happens is this war slogan was basically used. So it is a war cry, right, which basically the Mukti Vahini used extensively for getting the independence from the Pakistan, right, during the Bangladesh liberation war in 1971. All right. And in March 2020, the Bangladesh High Court also declared the Joy Bangla as a national slogan of the country of Bangladesh. So Joy Bangla is basically the national slogan of the Bangladesh. All right. All right, next, the STARS project. Okay, let's understand the STARS project. So what is the STARS project? You must understand. Okay, so STARS project, STARS means basically the strengthening, teaching, learning, and the results for the state, for the states. So this is basically, you know, you know, a project which was implemented by the Ministry of Education, okay, you know, along with the Department of Economic Affairs. So the STARS project is in the news due to the financial support which will be provided by the World Bank, right? So here what happens is the agreement for the financial support for the implementation of this STARS project, okay, for, you know, the strengthening of teaching, learning and the results, right, especially among the states, right? So there will be, or there is an agreement for this financial support, which through that financial support, the STARS project will be implemented in the states, right? So there is an agreement between the Ministry of Education, right, the Department of Economic Affairs and the World Bank through the Ministry of Education, all right? So this, you know, the STARS project was basically approved, right, in the October 2021 for their implementation. And this project basically emphasizes, right, incorporating the overall monitoring and the measurement activities, especially in the school or Indian school education system, where the education, quality education will be monitored, right, through certain set of interventions, okay? And these interventions would be done in the six states like Himachal Pradesh, Rajasthan, Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, Kerala, and Orissa. Regarding implementation mechanism, right, the STARS project would be implemented through newly centrally sponsored scheme, right? So here it will be implemented as the newly centrally sponsored scheme through, the Department of School Education and the Literacy, right, under Ministry of Education. So the Department of School Education and the Literacy would basically implement this newly centrally sponsored scheme in our country at the central level. Okay, so at the central level or at the national level, the Department of School Education and the Literacy would implement, and at the state level, this project or the STARS project would be implemented through the Integrated State Implementation Society for Samagra Shiksha. Okay, for every state, there will be a State Implementation Society for the Samagra Shiksha, and that will basically implement the STARS project in our country, right, at the state level. Okay, next, InFact 18. Okay, so first of all, you must understand, it is basically, you know, a vessel. It is a marine vessel which was used by the Indian Army. So its name was InFact 18. InFact means Indian Naval Fast Attack Craft T18. Okay, so it is a InFact vessel which is basically Super Dhruva MK second class, right, which was built by Goa Shipyards Limited, right, in 1999. Okay, so here this vessel was built by Goa Shipyard and was ultimately handed over to Indian Navy, right, in 1999. And this vessel, which is known as InFact 18, was decommissioned means it will no longer will be useful, right, for the operational purpose. So it will be decommissioned from the work, right, from the task which is assigned to that vessel, right? So it is decommissioned on January 28, 2021, right, at the naval dockyard in the Mumbai, because it has served the nation for 20 years, okay, from around 1999 to 2021. So it has served around 20 years of the national service, all right, so which has contributed to separate set of, or the, you know, most important aspect of the national security for various vigilance in the marine areas, right? So regarding this InFact 18 vessel, so it is a 25 meter long vessel which was used by the Indian Navy, okay, which has a 60 tons displacement capacity, okay, of the water, and it is built by the Goa Shipyard Limited in collaboration with the MS Ramta of Israel, and it was commissioned to Indian Navy in 1999, okay? And this InFact 18 vessel was specially designed for the shallow waters, so it can venture into the shallow water, okay? It can have the speed of the 85 or 45 knots, and it has the capability of day-night surveillance. That means it can surveillance in the marine areas, right? During the day as well in the night, right? It can also involve in reconnaissance operations, search and rescue operations, right, beach insertions, right, extractions of marine commandos, right, the high speed interceptions of the intruder craft also being used through this, you know, InFact 18 vessel. So it has the tremendous capacity of the surveillance, right, during day and night for the security purpose, and it was used by the Indian, you know, Navy. So it is basically the Infact 18 vessel. Okay, next, first PPP research reactor for production of the nuclear medicine. Okay, so first of all, the nuclear medicines are basically an isotopes, okay, which are used, right, for example, for various types of cancer, right, cancer therapies, right. I'm just giving one example. So it can be used for any, you know, medicinal purposes, like, you know, treatment of the cancer. Okay, the in India, almost all nuclear medicines are produced by the bark. Okay, so the bark, right, the first such PPP research reactor, right, which will be commissioned. Okay, so here the design for the first PPP reactor. PPP means public private partnership. Okay, PPP means public private partnership. Okay, so here the public private partnership reactor or research reactor would be developed, right? A design for that would be implemented, okay, for the production of nuclear medicines or the isotopes. Okay, so the BARC or Bhabha Atomic Research Center, which is a premier research organization and Department of Atomic Energy, right, which will take out the design for implementation of this first PPP research reactor. As I told you, almost 100% of these nuclear medicines will be produced by the BARC until now, but now it will be produced by the PPP mode, right? That means the private sector or the private entities will be involved in the production of the nuclear medicines or the isotopes. Okay, so that means the private entities will have the exclusive right. Until now, there was no such right, but now the private entities will have the exclusive right to process and to market these isotopes, which will be used as a nuclear medicines, right? And which will be produced in the research reactors, right? And so that it can be investing, or these private entities could be investing in the reactor and the processing facilities. Okay, why this the first PPP research reactor was there? Because in the May 2020, the finance minister basically announced the establishment of a research reactor on the PPP mode. Okay, so the finance minister basically announced for that, and following this, right, the first such design for the PPP reactor would be, you know, would have announced by the Bhabha Atomic Research Center. Okay, and that reactor would produce the medical isotopes, right, as a part of Atmanirbhar Bharat, right, which makes our country Atmanirbhar in terms of production of these isotopes. Okay, this project would be a major step towards making India as a self-reliant, right, in terms of production of these radioisotopes, right, which will be used in the medicinal and the industrial applications. Okay, globally, if you compare this, you know, the nuclear, you know, medicines, the nuclear medicine comprises of around $6 billion market. Okay, this $6 billion market would be expected to grow, right, to up to $30 billion by 2030, right? So India is having the huge, you know, potential of contribution of this market. Okay, and currently India produces all major isotopes in our country under the aegis of Bhabha Atomic Research Center. All right, next, Prabuddha Bharata. So Prabuddha Bharata is nothing but basically a general. Okay, it was a general, or it is a general. So the Prime Minister Narendra Modi would address the 125th anniversary celebrations of Prabuddha Bharata. Okay, so Prime Minister Narendra Modi would address this anniversary celebrations of Prabuddha Bharata. Okay, on 31st of January 2021. Okay, so here, the celebrations were basically related to its anniversary, which is 125th of the Prabuddha Bharata, which is nothing but a general. Okay, this event would be organized by Advaita Ashrams, right, Mayavati. Okay, so here, as I told you, that Prabuddha Bharata is basically a monthly general, okay, of the Ramakrishna order, which was started by Swami Vivekananda in 1896. So it is a, you know, the old magazine or old journal, which was published by or started by Swami Vivekananda. Okay, and why this Prabuddha Bharata? Because it is an important medium of spreading the message of India's ancient spiritual wisdom. So through that journal, the message related to the India's ancient spiritual wisdom would be you know, spread out, right, throughout the world. Okay. And regarding his publication, the publication was basically started from the Chennai, right, which was also known as Madras. Okay. It continued to publish for 2 years. And after that, it has been shifted to Elmora in Uttar Pradesh, Uttarakhand. All right. And then in 1899, the place of publication from Elmora, which is in Uttarakhand, have been again shifted to Advaita Ashram. And from that Advaita Ashram, it is still continued to publish this journal monthly. All right. So it is, a poster of Prabuddha Bharata, which is first published by Swami Vivekananda in 1896 itself. All right. So thank you very much for attending this session. We'll meet again tomorrow for the next news. Thank you.